All right, we're here today on a beautiful Cambridge afternoon, and I'm here with my friend Jordi, who is a PhD student in material science. And today we're going to be looking at some of the research you do in the lab. So tell us what's going to be happening.
Yeah, so we're going to go inside this building, the material science department, and I'm going to show you some of the most advanced microscopes in the world. And after that, you'll get to see how we prepare our samples, which are new materials for solar energy.
Awesome. Okay, and so tell the people why your research is so important. You know, why should they care?
Well, climate change and global warming is a fact, and we need new technologies to produce electricity and energy sustainably, and solar power is going to play a huge role. So what we do in our research group, we look into new materials called perovskites, which will help produce solar energy in a cheaper and easier way. To understand why they work, why they don't, we need very, very good microscopes. So do you want to see them? We can go inside
and
I'll show you.
Let's have a look. Yeah.
The microscopes we're gonna see are a special type of microscopes called electron microscopes, which allow us to see the atomic scale. So you're very lucky today because I'm going to show you three of them and we're gonna get to use one. And this is the one we're gonna be using today. It's called OSIRIS, like the
supervised radiation area.
Yeah. It's fine because it's all contained within like metallic boxes.
So we're in the TM room?
Exactly, we're inside the TM room. TM, remember, it stands for transmission electron microscopy. And the reason why this room is so big and probably you can hear it is very quiet is because on the walls we have some dampening material that stops any sort of noise interference from interrupting our microscopy, because again we need very, very, very high quality signals. So apart from the microscope we use today, this is a facility. So we have many other microscopes. Every microscope is unique in its way. So let's go and see some of the other ones.
Oh, okay. So this one looks a bit more old school, actually.
This one is old school. This is for training, actually.
Right.
It's very good at what it does, but it's a bit simpler to use.
I like how you have this this old school little TV over here. It's kind of cute.
So that's one, but I want to show you the impressive one, like the one that you'll be like, my goodness.
Okay, so this one's pretty cool. The other one was pretty decent, but now we're about to see...
The big one.
The big one.
The one that allows us to see atom by atom.
We're at the Titan.
The Titan, yeah,
so
there is...
You know it's going to be a good one if it's called the Titan.
It's a very big one. So you can see again, double door, but this is a... The special thing about this big microscope is that it can actually resolve, it can actually see atom by atom. And the reason it can do that is, first of all, it has better components, but second, it has something that we call a corrector, a very, very fancy set of magnets and electronic components that will correct the formation of your electron beam.
So this is some images that have been taken with the big Titan microscope.
Exactly. So the reason, so you can see these dots, right? These are the atoms of our material. And that's why the bigger you go, the better you get to see these atoms. The one we use today, it's not as big. It doesn't have correction.
Okay.
So it cannot resolve such great images.
But, that's the difference. The smaller microscopes, they're still...
Oh, they work very well. And
still work, you know, just as you need.
Exactly. And you don't need to always understand atom by atom,
doesn't
right?
It doesn't always have to be massive.
Exactly, right? No. Size doesn't matter for most of the times.
We've seen all the awesome big microscopes. We've gone on a bit of a tour. So it's back to the one that we're going to be doing some measurements today
on. Exactly.
So we're at the machine now, which allows you to see individual atoms. So essentially the ultimate resolution of any microscope. And my question is, you know, how does this thing work?
It all starts right there at the top, at the electron gun.
Electron gun. So when you say electron gun, do you mean like something I can kind of use to, not that I would want to.
No, it's an analogy, because yeah, at the end of the day, what we have there is a very sharp tip where we apply some voltage, some energy, and from there we can accelerate electrons, and these electrons, they come out from the tip at very high energy.
Kind of spontaneously when you apply these
exactly
strong voltages?
And continuously.
Okay, and you produce the stream of electrons sort of
going
down,
shooting down from the top to the bottom of the microscope.
Right, okay, and what happens next?
So then we want to get this electron beam as small and as condensed as possible, because the smaller we can condense this beam,
right,
the better the resolution we get, so the more we can see. And we do that through all these different elements, these boxes here. They are called electromagnetic lenses. Mm-hmm. And a lens is, in the same way, you would, for light, control how light moves with glass, right? We do the same, but using magnets and using electric fields, because electrons are negatively charged. So by applying some electric and magnetic fields, we can control where these electrons move. And by that, we can get from the electron gun to our sample a very, very sharp beam. Then we put our sample in, which is our solar cells, and then this very focused beam will go through the sample, interact with it, and then it will produce signals which we will collect with our detectors more in the bottom of the microscope.
Okay, so you're in the process of setting up the TM measurement, mm-hmm, and there's a lot of crazy sort of funky things that you're doing on the computer. And just to sort of explain it for the uninitiated, what's going on?
So basically, as we said, we have a lot of lenses, a lot of magnets, and a lot of currents that we need to tweak in order to focus our beam to our sample, mm-hmm, in the best possible way. So all I'm doing is changing some of these parameters to align the electron beam to be as small and as parallel and as perfect as possible. It's not for epilepsy, people. So now we've finished all the alignment and we were able to take some pictures of our sample. Mm-hmm. As you can see, our sample here has some nanocrystals all around it. And these nanocrystals are below the micrometer scale. And if we zoom in, we can start to see some of the shapes and how each of these crystals is connecting to the other. And what is more interesting then is, because we're not only able to tell how these materials look, but also what they're made of. So what we can do is we can select some area of interest and we can start to set a map of composition. So it's a map that will tell us what elements or what materials our nanocrystals are made of.
Okay, so what you're saying is that not only can you get the image of your crystals at that really small resolution, but you can also get this other information about the actual elements inside those crystals and whether you have different elements at different spots.
Okay, so here you can see we've changed our sample and now we've seen that this sample, compared to the first one, has smaller crystals in it. So that's very informative because we understand how changing some parameters during the fabrication of our samples has led to a different morphology. Now we've changed our sample once more, and as you can see here, we have a continuous film. We can start to see how different this sample is to the other ones, and you can see we no longer have individual crystals, but a continuous network of crystals, and that's very good for solar cells because it will allow our light to be absorbed across the whole area rather than in very small bits. Mm. So that sample is definitely better than the other two we saw.
Right. OK, Okay, so we have finished up at the transmission electron microscope. So, you know, as amazing and as wonderful as microscopy is, I'm sure, you know, you don't just look at microscopes in your PhD. There's many sort of activities or things that you have to do as part of your research. So what are some of the other things that you have to do?
Yeah, so PhD? So I get to fabricate my own solar cells with the help of many people in my group. And that involves a lot of practical work in the lab. We use something called glove boxes, which is basically an isolated box, and that's where our lab is. It's in something we call inert air, so it's air without oxygen, without water, so our samples don't react with unwanted stuff. And I really like that part of my PhD, because I come from a chemistry background, and it's very hands-on, it's very practical.
Right.
And as you can see, my PhD involves chemistry, it involves physics, it involves material science, as we saw today with the microscopy. This is what I really like the most of being a PhD student. It's very interdisciplinary work.
So obviously, you know, all this stuff is really, really cool. These microscopes are pretty freaking awesome, let's be honest. But how does it connect to the broader picture? You know, how is your research actually helping people in the real world? You know?
So perovskite-wise, we are trying to develop new materials that are basically inks. So you would be able to print a solar cell. So imagine, in the same way you print a sheet of paper, you could be able to put some ink and print a solar cell. So that's the biggest aim.
And I imagine that would be a pretty easy way of making solar cells.
Absolutely, and making them available to everyone, rich and poor countries worldwide. But I think the reason why I chose to do my PhD and it goes beyond this specific application is that to me, climate change and the need for sustainable technologies is one of the biggest challenges in our century. And I just wanted to be part of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
As simple as that.
And if from the broad perspective of your research works and you're able to develop these new types of solar cells, that could have a massive impact on actually dealing with climate change.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And tackling this huge challenge.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so before we end, I just have one last question for you, Jordi.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, you know, what is life actually like as a PhD student?
I really try to have a very good work-life balance.
Yeah.
And I do a lot of things outside the labs and outside microscopy. I do improvised theater.
Okay.
Every time you do a show, it goes differently. So that's a lot of fun. I play handball, which is a team sport. And apart from that, we have a very good social life here with a lot of dinners and pub trips and just casual conversations. So
yeah, totally. Definitely at Cambridge, you can actually have a really nice life and go out a lot and have a lot of fun. So I would agree with you. I think it's a lot of fun.
I always think if you just did one or the other, you would be missing something. So it's this balance that just makes your time here great. And that's it.
Awesome.
Awesome. Goodbye. How do you finish the video, actually?
No, I don't really have a good way of finishing.
Please like, subscribe to the video, and if you want to see more, type it down there in the comments below.
Oh, that is class. That is class. We might use that now. And I need you to like and subscribe.